What if I told you there was a virus going around that the majority of our children were at risk for catching? What if I told you this virus causes memory problems and increased risk for depression and diabetes? Worse yet, what if I told you that scientists know both the cause and the cure for this virus, but as a society, we're doing virtually nothing to stop its progression? Well, this epidemic is real, and 2/3 of our children are suffering from it. Only it's not a virus, it's sleep deprivation. So sleep might not be something you've gotten a lot of talk to, right? You just put your head on the pillow, and then you wake up when the alarm clock tells you. But sleep is so much more than that. And we can't really dialogue about transforming education without first considering how the brain transforms itself, because that's what learning is, brain transformation. Sleep is a requirement of the brain. Without it, we die. Without enough of it, we suffer. During sleep, the brain rids itself of cellular waste, strengthens synaptic connections, consolidates memories. In fact, if you spend your day learning new guitar chords, at night, areas of your right motor cortex responsible for your left fingers actually sleep deeper. So sleep, it's not wasted time. It's sacred time. Every day, when our brains are busy making the changes they need for us to learn, to survive, for our children to grow and thrive. I study sleep in college students. Just like the rest of us, when they don't get the sleep they need, their bodies go into fight or flight mode. Stress hormones course through their arteries. Their blood pressure and blood sugar spike. They seek out junk food. Their frontal lobes become inefficient at problem solving. Their limbic systems, highly emotionally reactive. In fact, we've shown that in college students, bad sleep is a better predictor of who will and who won't succeed academically than is binge drinking and marijuana use. Let's admit it. As a society, we're bad at sleeping. We don't prioritize it. We certainly don't model good behaviors for our children. No surprise, then, that United States school children rank first among nations in academic problems directly attributable to sleepiness. The 2014 Sleep in America poll found that fewer than 1 in 5 teens is getting the minimum amount of recommended sleep. So how much is that? In teens, that's about 9 hours a night, and younger kids, at least 10. But here's an easier way to tell whether or not you or your children are getting enough sleep. Do they need an alarm clock to wake up? If so, they're not getting enough sleep. So what can we do to help our children get better sleep? 3 suggestions. First, start schools later. Right now, the earliest scheduled bus stop is 5:40 a.m. Right? The school start later research movement has shown if you delay the time of day high school start, it's a win-win situation. Kids get more sleep, attendance rates go up, ACT scores rise, car accidents by teen drivers plummets. That's why the American Academy of Pediatrics recommends that high school start no earlier than 8:30 a.m. Should we really be sacrificing children's health for transportation savings? Second, remember that we are sun-seeking creatures. Light is the primary signal the brain uses to establish sleep-wakefulness rhythms, and this circuitry is millions of years old. People of all ages learn better, feel better, sleep better when they get plenty of bright light exposure during the day. And yet, we're sending our children to spend their days like moles in windowless rooms and dark classrooms. So let's apply the architectural principle of daylighting so that children can actually see the light of day when they're learning. A study of over 21,000 elementary school students found that children with the most natural light in their classrooms progressed 20% faster in 1 year in reading and math than children from the same schools with the least amount of light. Third, let's make sleep a public health campaign. If we got the lead out of paint, teens out of tanning beds, parents on the lookout for cyberbullies, can't we educate parents and teachers about the importance of setting bedtimes, keeping electronics out of the bedrooms, keeping energy drinks away from children? Right now, Sleep isn't even on parents' radar as a health concern to be worried about, even though half of the things they are worried about are directly and profoundly impacted by poor sleep. Without a public health campaign, parents and teachers might not realize that falling asleep in class is not a choice or a sign of laziness, but an inevitable consequence of a brain so tired, so exhausted, so low on nourishment that it takes away the keys to consciousness. It took us a while, but we finally realized that hungry children don't learn well, so we brought free and reduced lunch programs to schools. It's time we realize sleepy children don't learn well either. This traditional Setswana greeting translates to, "Hello, how did you wake up?" Can you imagine if we ask that of our children? Can you imagine if we really paid attention to their answers? Thank you. Sleep long, sleep well.